share their views on something that is so critical to the future of urban India: infrastructure and smart cities. Here, before I invite the chair and the other speakers on the stage, if we can only wish that what we heard from some of our other earlier speakers of what the metro rail, which was made possible in New Delhi by Japanese funding, if it can rub off some of its achievements on Mumbai too, and I think it's really crucially needed, because I think that with the Metro 3 now most likely to be a possibility soon, we have those lovely 9 lines drawn on the map of Mumbai, of the 9 metro lines that we have been promised that we'll get one day. So probably if we can learn some of that discipline from Japan and get our act together and see that as a possibility in our lifetimes, I think that will be a great achievement for all of us. And we wish the MMRDA and the government all the best, so we can get the gift of the metro, all the 9 lines, in our lifetime at least. Because as of now, with the slow progress of things, because of a lot of external reasons, it's more like a 100-year plan. So, and it's not just transport, it's just one element of what can be smart or what can be good sustainable infrastructure. It's just about everything: water, energy, sanitation, public health, education, gender equity, equal access to the differently abled. The list is endless on what can possibly call a smart urban habitat. And so to discuss this, we have a distinguished panel. I'll quickly go through the introductions. We have Dr. Kulwant Singh. We have Mr. Rajendra Jagtap, who is the Additional Municipal Commissioner from Pune. Pune, as we all know, it's a great matter of pride for Maharashtra, and that only of the 2 cities that were shortlisted for the list of 20 smart cities in India, Pune and Solapur are the only 2 Maharashtra cities. And I'm really thankful to the commissioner and to the additional commissioner, sir, for making it. Because we were not unable to get any other government representative who kept us hanging till the very end. And it was just a matter of a phone call just about a couple of days ago that I had with the commissioner of the Pune Municipal Corporation. And he was very kind enough to send Rajendra ji to share his views with us. We have Mr. Shinobu Yamamoto, who is a Mumbai representative from Yokohama, a city that has been lauded as one of the best practices for urban transformation by just about every agency in the world, and actually being called a smart city. We will have Mr. Vivek Sahai, who is a former chairman of the Railway Board, and now we are very proud that he is our distinguished fellow at ORF, and we are working to get some major policy interventions for transport and logistics under his guidance. So, Dr. Kulwant Singh.
Good afternoon, friends. I am breaking the tradition in the sense that as a chairperson of the session, I decided to make a short presentation, because the subject was such, as Mr. Desai said, what is a smart city? It's something which the Government of India, while introducing the scheme, has also not defined it. Therefore, I would also like to take this opportunity very briefly introducing UN Habitat, which is a UN agency for cities and towns. Friends, 40 years ago, when the agency was established, the world had 4 billion people on this planet. And 37% of that 4 billion were living in urban areas. In 2014, the globe, had 7 billion people. They added 3 billion people on this planet. And interestingly enough, of this 7 billion, 54 to 55% people are living in urban areas. By 2050, we are expecting the globe to have 9.5 to 10 billion people. And almost like 65 to 70% will be living in urban areas. The agency, therefore, is seized with the whole issue, how the globe, how the world, how these 200 countries, 193 member countries of UN will be coping up with this challenge of urbanization, which is really happening. And therefore, I thought that, you see, I will like to, you know, share with you some of the thoughts and some of the vision of UN Habitat in this regard. This conference basically is based, no doubt, about Indo-Japan cooperation, but it's also focusing on ideas and actions for a better India. UN Habitat has been closely working with Japan, and Government of Japan's support has been a very major one, because we have, for the Asia and Pacific, our regional office in Fukuoka, Japan, you know. And we have been very closely working with the Government of Japan and getting big support from them in this regard. So my couple of minutes will be devoted to share with you UN Habitat's vision, because we are currently working on what we call New Urban Agenda. In the month of October 2016, there is going to be the first global conference which will set the agenda for next 20 years. You know, how should the cities be managed, basically? In this regard, very particularly, I would like to say that during the last 50, 60 years or so, most probably I would say post-Second World War period, what have we really seen? And I think what we see is we have got the rapid, unmanaged and unplanned urban growth, basically. We have got slums, we have got housing backlog, we have got almost like 20 million housing backlog in India. We have a backlog of urban infrastructure and services. There's a kind of urban sprawl which is there. There's a growing car dependency, you know, largely for our mobility. There's a kind of urban planning based on high level of zoning. And, you know, there is a segregation within the society. There is an exclusion within the society. That's what we really feel. And what's happening is there is a loss of street life, you know, in a way. And high energy demand and emission of greenhouse gases, which are largely there. This is the kind of urbanization that we are experiencing. I just picked up a few of the photographs. This is basically, and this is how, as a matter of fact, the, you know, our master plans are leading to areas where nobody is really seen, there's no street life, nothing of that kind, and these are the kind of things that are getting developed. So we have to really think in terms of what kind of smart urban development that we are really thinking, from moving from urban sprawl to compactness of the cities, segregation to integration, and congestion to connectivity. So therefore, what we call as a smart cities, we are really thinking in terms of what kind of 21st century smart urban model should be, basically. We are thinking, I've just listed few things, basically, with a high quality of public space, which is very, very important. Then proper and well-designed densities, which have to be there, but mixed urban uses, which are very, very important, both for the social integration and otherwise. Improving connectivity so that, you know, there is an emphasis on walking distances, public transport, ICT, and others. It's very important that our social structures should be mixed ones. urban resilience is adopting a very big importance, keeping in view the climate change resilience. As you know, sustainable development goal that got adopted last September focused largely on a individual goal, goal 11 as we call it, to make the habitats which are safe, which are resilient, which are inclusive, and which are sustainable. I think these are the four features which become important. If you achieve it, you make your cities and habitats very smart. Energy sustainability is going to be a major issue in the current century. And of course, you know, you also need practical and enforceable norms and rules which are both participatory and democratic. Let me just basically say what we are arguing about is that you need to have planned city extensions and not something that, you know, organically gets developed. And you have to have a city-wide strategy. Without that, perhaps I think you'll not be able to make the cities smart. I'm not discussing in detail about the benefits of smart city extensions, which are both economic, environmental, and social. But our UN Habitat's main approach is to focus on A, urban planning and design, focus on robust financial planning, and having rules and regulations. These are the three legs that we try to insist upon so that, you know, if one falls, the system fails. Because we need a form that generates value, we need good rules and regulations, and a financial plan that manages value and attracts investment. Let's talk a little bit about our own country, India. We have almost like of these 7 billion people on the planet, almost like 18-19% of the population lives in India. And our urban system is second largest in the world. We were 377 million people in 2011. Last year, 2015, we were 428 million people. We have got an unprecedented expansion in our urban base. From 5161 urban settlements in 2001, we got 7935, almost 8,000 in 2011. You know, the way, for example, you know, the system has been expanding, urban base has been expanding, we really need to take care of that. India is moving towards city-based urbanization and what we call class one cities, 100,000 population and above, they account for 70% of the total urban population. With increasing share of city population, it's often used to suggest that there is a kind of unevenness in India's urban system. Larger cities growing at a faster pace, and much of the increasing share is, however, explained by size class jumping phenomena. I will just like to mention, since this session is talking mainly about infrastructure and smart cities, let's see our position with respect to the infrastructure. If you see the deficits in infrastructure so far as India is concerned, with the 2011 census, which clearly indicates the households without treated tap water within their own premises, there are more than 50%. 50% above households are there which do not have, you know, you may say that treated tap water within their premises. We are talking only of urban India. We are not talking of rural India. If you take latrines within premises connected to piped sewer, 67% of the families do not have it. Solid waste collection, almost 25% of the solid waste from the cities is not collected on a daily basis. And wastewater connected to covered sewerage, 55% or more. So these are sort of, you know, very startling deficits, which as a matter of fact really would like to tell us how do we really manage it. Government has taken several initiatives. You know, so far we had a very major program, what was called JNNURM, Jawaharlal Nehru National Urban Renewal Mission, which was launched in 2005. We do have national sanitation policy, but we do not have a national urban policy. You know, Smart Cities Mission and Amrut, which are, as a matter of fact, two major initiatives of this government, basically, they are focusing largely on infrastructure, wherein water supply, sanitation, and solid waste management and other basic infrastructure occupy a primate position. Well, there are guidelines for the smart city which Government of India has really given, but what they are saying is they have not defined it, but they say a smart city has to have basic infrastructure. It uses possibly smart solutions to make infrastructure and services efficient and better. And of course, you know, the policy is to rely on area-based development step by step and then have a pan-city approach and like that. Objectives are very clear. Provide basic infrastructure, quality of life improvement, clean and sustainable environment, and of course, applying smart solutions. But what is the basic infrastructure we are talking about? Basic infrastructure includes assured water and electricity supply, sanitation and solid waste management, efficient urban mobility and public transport, affordable housing. Rest, of course, is there. Robust IT connectivity. You do have the program now, Digital India and others. You have the issue of safety and security of citizens, health and education and all that. You know, economic activities and livelihood opportunities. And therefore, you know, the initiatives, as a matter of fact, first have to be area-based, step-by-step, and then the pan-city, basically. The approach is either through retrofitting for the existing parts of the built area of the cities, or redevelopment, or greenfield kind of development for the newer areas. There are several smart solutions which have been mentioned in the guidelines. I just repeated them. But I would like to urge upon and say that, you know, we have to really work for building our infrastructure, which actually is inclusive, tries to reach to everyone. And where, as a matter, we heard this morning in the economic cooperation session with Japan, there are many things that we can, for example, not only learn, but also, perhaps I think, gain from them to improve and implement our smart cities, you know, areas. There is an interest which has been expressed during the visit of the Prime Minister of Japan, Mr. Abe, saying that, you know, he would like to give a helping hand for the smart city solutions. The $35 billion loan which is coming basically can also be, you know, mainly for implementing some of those infrastructure projects. We do have a very distinguished panel. Among them is the, you know, I would say representative of the Municipal Corporation of Pune, one of the top 20 cities that has been selected basically for, you know, implementing the scheme in the first stage. Let me just say that government, both center and state, are in one sense in the first 5 years contributing 1,000 crores for each city. But that 1,000 crore does not mean that, you know, the city cannot raise more resources. A city like New Delhi Municipal Corporation, which is one of the first list of 20, are planning to invest almost like 5,000 crores, you know, for this purpose, raising resources from other means, including using resources which are available from Amrut program or others. There is also the question of public-private partnership. There can also be leveraging of funds with support from, you know, external sources, including, I would say, that Japan. So in that sense, if we are working for the smart cities and building the infrastructure, perhaps I think there is need for even getting the technology for wastewater treatment. Japan has a lot to share with us on that. In fact, wastewater treatment. I would say even practices for solid waste management. And I even would like to say that they have contributed richly during the last, you know, I would say a few decades in this country, not only for improving, I would say, the transport, the personal transport through various, you know, I would say cars, which are being, you know, in a way constructed in this country, but also I would contributing for the rapid metro, which we did it in Delhi, and now they are supporting in many other places. So we'd like to hear from the panel how, as a matter of fact, we are going to move ahead for this. I would first like to invite for this purpose Mr. Rajendra from Additional Municipal Commissioner Pune to share with us basically, you know, how Pune is planning in a way to implement the smart cities program in their own city and how they are going to make their city much more inclusive, much safer, the application of technology and others. Thank you so much.
Good evening, everybody. I thank the chair to give me the opportunity to have a presentation at the first go itself, because I have to rush back to Pune again, and since we are running late on time already, I'll request you to excuse me also after our presentation. I'll be holding on for just a few minutes after that. When we talk about the smart city initiatives, the government of India had come out with a very novel and innovative scheme with urban development and the smart city initiative, wherein out of those 100 enlisted cities by the government of India, they had a competition going on based on certain fixed parameters, wherein all the cities had to participate, and through this medium they had a selection of the first 20 cities, and as it is rightly said, among the first 20 cities, Pune was the first runners-up, second to come in the total list as per the scoring patterns that were given to us. Now, when we talk about the smart cities, there were some set guidelines which were issued by the government of India, based on which we had formulated our plan and submitted our views pertaining to what best we could do for the city of Pune, based on pan-city initiatives that are at the whole city level. And out of the three options that were given to us, we went in for the area development and how we selected the areas, how we had the citizen engagement. I have some set of slides which I will go through. The slides will be available here in detail for all of us to see with the organizers as well as on our website of Pune Municipal Corporation. This is the same presentation, a little bit modified and reduced, which we had submitted to the Government of India. When we talk about the smart city initiatives, we talk about Pune especially, wherein a city of 250 square kilometers and a population of 40 lakh, a budget existing of around 4,200 crores annually, we are looking at a development wherein our area and density was on the rise, a neighboring Pumpri-Chinchwad Municipal Corporation and industrial setup coming up equally big in size, and our own problems pertaining to urban infrastructure and development after our initial benefits and things which we did under GNRM. So the smart city competition itself was cut across three different areas, wherein the city level criteria had 30% of its mark among the vision and goals that we envisage, that we compiled and collected through citizen engagement itself, that we'll be having in the further slides again. The strategic plan as to how we plan to achieve these visions and goals over a period of time, initial plan of 5 years and gradually over a period of 10 to 15 years. Then how we went in for citizen engagement by different means, both offline and online. Then the baseline that we had as to the existing capacities that we have and how we plan to improve upon. The second area of focus was the area-based proposal, which carried 55% of the total setup and marks, which dealt with an area development, which we, how we identified that area, how we selected it, and what we propose for that area development, where in this view it was Aund, Baner, Balewadi.
Then third was the pan-city initiatives that we had, the proposal 15% of the marks divided for that. As to what are the parameters and areas that are of focus for the city as whole, and it is not just one area that we develop, but also some major departments and areas which across the city, for the whole city, we take into consideration, where transportation, water and solid waste were our priority areas. Then Pune, we had the stock chances of coming up in the top 10 because we had undertaken extensive citizen involvement, where more than 50% of the households were reached up to. Then we had the blessings from our political bosses, the representatives. We had 5 different major parties, 3-4 smaller parties, who all of them participated and helped us in reaching out to the people and having an initiative and a go-ahead for almost 3.5 months without any disturbance from their side. A strong ecosystem to drive this thing, because besides the municipal corporation itself, we outreached in form of students, then a lot of colleges in Pune, a lot of software companies, then corporates, NGOs, press, and a lot of other medias were introduced into the system, which helped us to reach out to a lot of different people and to get back feedbacks and views from them also. Then we came out with comprehensive solutions, where short and long-term solutions on critical issues, first coming from the citizens, then from the expert groups, which were compiled, collected, and discussed at length as per each subject and each topic over a period of time. Then the model plan for application. We had a lot of things which came in from different parts of the world and replications within India also. We had a lot of interaction with different people, different persons coming from, say, Barcelona, London, Singapore, and other countries, where application of some smart technology or some kind of a network or some kind of an initiatives had already been undertaken, and how best we could adapt them or undergo after some innovation and put into use practicably for a city like Pune was under consideration in this. Then the phases in that particular period, over a period of time, was in 5 major stages. That is envision, where we went in for citizen engagement and compiling all information that we wanted as per what best requirements of the citizens are there. Then second was diagnosing, having a data compilation and running through various data that was compiled and putting up an analysis into it. Then the third phase was in October itself for co-create. That is, we asked for solutions at pan-city levels, both to experts as well as the citizens. Then to refine it, refine was here we set up different labs as per the subject, where we called in all other people who were concerned with that particular subject, experts and all other people, and they came out with a proper streamlining as to the time limit for each of those proposals, projects and everything, and to incorporate them. And finally then sharing it again with the public and coming for the last suggestion or objections that would come for to include in the smart city initiatives. So the first part about it was the citizen engagement, wherein we had more than 34 lakh inputs and votes from citizens at different levels, which was undertaken in a period of around 3.5 months. And we could look at different pan-city initiatives, where the first stage itself involved first moving from door to door, distributing our set forms, wherein compilation of data physically from each doorstep was undertaken. While doing this, we compiled all mobile numbers, email IDs, or any other form of medium that we could collect to interact in the future stages by way of online medium. So we don't have to come again for a physical survey, which is quite time-consuming and requires a lot of manpower and others. Then again, we had a second phase for area development, where another set of survey was undertaken and various parameters were introduced to have citizen engagement in place. So the first phase, where we wanted to identify pan-city initiatives, and what the citizens threw to us was these 6 major areas, where transportation and mobility, when we look at the percentage, we could see more than 30% of those people were concerned about that areas, and gradually come down to water supply, then is waste, fourthly is environment sustainability, then safety and security, and lastly energy. So these were the areas that were in fact picked up by the home survey and the online and offline medium that was available for the citizens. And based on this parameters that the first 3 initiatives of Pan City was selected, and then we went in for a further detailed looking into it. These are some of the photographs of the citizen engagement we done by the offline survey. This is the online engagement in form of different mediums, but Twitter, Facebook, by mobile applications, our web page and others, which was put into use. Then this is when we talk about the Pan-City initiatives, transport and mobility was the major area of focus, wherein public transportation itself, like rightly pointed out by our chairman here, is something which is of much grave concern, because the amount of cars and mobikes that go up in a city like Pune on an annual basis is quite high. For a population of 40 lakh, we have more than 25 lakh registered vehicles in the city of Pune. Our public transportation is in chaos. We have a public transportation SPV. It's a separate company which is there. Our metro is not yet through. And with such kind of situation, the road width, however, we have been able to increase in the last 20, 30 years through our development plans, has not been able to make up with the amount of traffic that is moving through. So public transport was an area of high concern. Along with that was to come out with solutions towards that. That is traffic management in form of synchronized traffic system in place, or to have a dedicated BRT for the bus transportation and public transportation. Then having proper footpaths for the citizens and pedestrians was another priority area. Then special cycle tracks which could be developed. There are some riverfront areas which could be developed, other areas which came up into this kind of initiatives. Second was pertaining to water and sewage. So when you talk about water, 24/7 is in one area of concern where everybody wants to have his tap water running 24 hours a day. And for that, again, the distribution network. For a city like Pune is when you are an old historical city which has grown from the center outwards, with addition of almost same area that was existing earlier, happening every 20 years. So from the core, when you move towards your outside, there's bound to be some problems of infrastructure provision into the outskirt areas with the equivalent pressure and everything. The geographical area there itself does not foresee us to have an equitable distribution throughout with the existing system, where you have ups and downs all across with mountain slopes and hillocks coming in between, and old network of water lines existing side by side to the existing new networks that we plan or propose to make. So 24/7 water supply is an area which we look forward to be undertaken by metering and having additional infrastructure in place. Then grievance redressal is another area which was of focus here, wherein smart bulk meters for existing system of water, overhead water tanks and others, and metering at the doorstep itself. Along with that, for the sewage, we are being planning with a large initiative from JICA, where more than 1,000 crore plus of a loan has been proposed. And we'll be having more than 12 different sewage treatment plants catering to around 250 MLD of sewage to be treated over a period of next 2 to 3 years. So probably we'll be coming up with a much better better rivers to flow for the city of Pune in future. Then again, what were our parameters that we looked forward in the coming two pan-city initiatives? For transport mobility is what we exist as of now, as per the benchmarking that we had done, and how we plan to improve it over a period of 5 years. So the figures may not be very high on the level of improvement, but gradually that is what we want to achieve and reach to some benchmarking targets is what we had put as something before us. The second initiative of Smart City was area development. And in area development, the area that we came across and we identified, again through a mode of citizen engagement and a kind of election or selection which was undertaken, is Aund, Baner and Balewadi. So the area that we look forward here, which has been a colored format. Envisage is Aund, which was an existing old Gauthan area or a city area which was densely populated. Baner, which is an upcoming area which has been developed over the last 8 to 10 years. And Balewadi, which is undergoing development stage at this present phase. We got a stretch of river there also, where a river development project also was initiated. And area development was again where most of the smart city initiatives were to be focused upon for development, which then can be replicated across the city in other areas. So the areas and initiatives that we had undertook for this Aund, Baner, Balewadi with a population of 40,000 is as follows. Under transport and mobility, these are the various factors that we identified: BRT corridor, redesigning of 27 kilometers of street, footpaths and others, public bicycle to be made available in this area, then smart multi-level car parking, another area of concern for the city of Pune itself and other places also, electric introduction of 100% electric buses and e-rickshaws on priority, smart bus stops where you are aware of the availability of buses itself. So that is a major factor. If the timing of the bus is not known, where people tend to go out for an auto rickshaw or any other mode of transportation. The second area. The other areas that were water and sewage, where again pan-city initiatives on a microscopic level are here. Waste and sanitation was area of focus where 100% segregation and other things were into place. Smart grid and solar network for energy saving and solar lighting was an area of area another focus. The riverfront development, which I talked about, where we want to develop our riverfront existing on that place. Slum development is another area where slums that were identified and the development of slums through SRA schemes as well as EWS is an area. The seventh is about e-governance and IT connectivity in this area to be having to go on 100% Wi-Fi across the area. Transit and startup hubs, especially for small initiatives like multi-parking and others. This is our funding mechanism which we had in place for the overall development. The first EBB is Aund Baner Balewati. A total investment we'll look at is 2,800 crores. For the Pan City is 780 crores and a total investment outlay of 3,630 crores. Again, it's 1,000 crores that's going to come from the central government and others that we have to raise from our own funds, some to come under BOT, PPP and other initiatives that we may take up with other firms at international and national level. Then for implementation of the whole smart city initiatives is the formation of a special purpose vehicle, which has been envisaged by the government of India, wherein 50% of the stake is to be done by the center as well as state government and 50% by the local body. The representatives who are to be there and the head of operations and how we meet and do it is given out here. And I'll just rush through the slides that were there pertaining to the photographic things. How do we look at for transformation of Pune? This is the river development, the street designing and street redesigning that we have in front. Again, the riverfront development. This is our public zone and performance gallery on the riverfront development. This is the parks and other public places that you are going to come. This is the street lighting that we have in place. The street light where we look at multiple uses for the particular street light. This is a public cycle transport that is we usually see abroad to come up in Aund Baner Balewadi, and the feeder network for the public transport which is already existing there. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. May I now invite Mr. Ramanna?
Session Chairman, Mr. Kulwant Singh, my colleagues on the dais, learned members in the audience. Though my presentation is basically covering the Metro Line 3, but considering the occasion being Indo-Japan cooperation and the smart city initiatives. As I go through the presentation, I would just like to highlight those points only and save everybody's time. Okay. Good evening. Thank you for the opportunity given to the Mumbai Metro Rail Corporation. Just before we go ahead, I would just like to give a glimpse of metropolitan region. The metropolitan region is already a 22 million population, 4,300 square kilometer geographical area with 22 million population, and expected to cross 30 million by 2031. So this is a phenomenal size of population and geography to cover. Public transport and all kinds of transport is really in bad shape. So around 2008, MMRDA has prepared an investment plan purely on the transport infrastructure. This is estimated to be around 2 lakh crores at 2008 prices. Okay, so I will not go into the conversion into the dollars, that is there on the slide. But if we see it now, it has already doubled. The requirement has already doubled. And we are expected to add 450 kilometers of metro rail network and 240 kilometers of suburban rail network to the metropolitan region, so that the transportation, level of transportation is would ease to any international city. Okay, this is typically a road and highway network and a public transport transit network. Okay, within that overall metropolitan region networks, this is about 170 kilometers Bombay specific metro requirement. Okay, I'm coming from over larger area to the finer area. Okay, then what is our mandate? Okay, metro master plan has been planned in an objective to turn Mumbai into a smart city. So within a reach of 1 to 2 kilometers, we are expected to provide a public transport access, track based public transport access. As of today, I think it's about 2 to 5 kilometers is the access distance for the suburban railway system, whereas we intend to reduce it to 1 kilometer by adding this network. Okay, that is the main objective. And apart from that, all the neighboring areas need to get connected. It need to get integrated with the existing BEST and suburban network and all those things. What is MMRC? MMRC is a joint venture company of Government of India and Government of Maharashtra. Initially set up to implement all the metro lines that will come in Mumbai, but right now our target is only limited to Metro Line 3. The rest of the lines are being implemented by MMRDA. And the line, 33.5 kilometers, it would address several aspects of the smart city requirement. The travel would ease from south to north as well as east to west, because it is going to get connected between Central Railway, Western Railway, and metro lines and monorails. And we are expected to cater to about 14 lakh trips by 2020, the first year of operation, and it would grow up to 17 lakhs, 1.7 millions. Okay. Though the financial returns are very, very insignificant for a project of this size, which is 23,136 crores, the only option was to go to JICA funding. I would say if Japanese funding would not have been made available to this project would never have seen the light of the day. In 2011 we started working, we went to Planning Commission, we went to Government of India, trying to convince them that this is a need of the city, we need to implement this project. But till then, the Japanese funding was not being made available to Mumbai city. It was only limited to Delhi and probably to Chennai and Bangalore, but Mumbai was not in the line. So we pursued. Japanese also shown a great interest to this project. Much earlier to 2011, they have already included it in their funding program. But fortunately, all the coordinates matched in around 2012 February. The project has been included in the rolling plan of JICA. So we were all jubilant, but by the time we reached 2012, the political dispensation in Japan started raising certain doubts about the project. So the project again has gone back. So we were only, from MMRDA and state government, we made a delegation visited Japan trying to convince the Japanese authorities. I think by March 2013, the new regime has come up. The current political regime has come up under the leadership of the Prime Minister Abe. So suddenly the project has again tossed up, and then on the day when the government of India was considering to include it in the Public Investment Board decision, on the same day, JICA has already announced the project to be funded at Japan. So that made the project's fortunes to never go back. Like it is a certain project to be funded. So finally, we clinched the project by July 2013, and a loan agreement was signed in September 2013. JICA agreed to fund 13,235 crores. That is about 57.2% of the project cost. So the JICA lending terms are well known to everybody: 1.4% interest rate, 30 years payback period. Okay. So the Japanese, certainly the cooperation, I would say the Japanese blessing is there on this project, without which this project would not have been possible. Okay. Salient features, yes, obviously this is going to be the most modern metro, because we have the advantage of the late starter. So all the technological developments, innovations that are possible at this point of time, we are incorporating in the project. The important factors are, like, we are going to get connected to international airport, which would reduce domestic and international terminals. That would make the travel in the city, especially the outbound traffic for especially airport and other, very, very comfortable, and below 1 hour journeys. Okay. Then we are going to deploy CBTC signaling system, which is again a Japanese pioneered signaling system, which would enable us to reduce our rolling stock requirement, as well as ensure very high frequencies. Okay. Where are we getting connected? We are getting connected to almost about 10 major employment centers, right from south to Mumbai, south to north, up to Sibs. We are also getting integrated with central and western suburban railways, the metro line 1 and monorail. Airports, I have already informed. We are also getting connected to bus terminals at Bombay Central. Another special feature of this project is we committed to provide an extended operation to the airport, so that typically Bombay has the international operations beyond midnight, the arrival flights and the departing flights overcrowding the skies beyond 12 o'clock. So we intend to operate this line up to 2:30, 3 o'clock early in the morning. So the line would actually have a very, very reduced operational period. That would be a great challenge for the project operation. But still, we have taken it up as our responsibility to offer a smart and comfortable public transport system for the city and, of course, the airport also. Okay. The benefits, environmental benefits, are well known. We are going to be reducing about 4.5 lakh vehicles. We'll be reducing using the parallel road system, and 2.4 lakh liters per day of fuel consumption. And of course, that would give enormous benefits to the environment, and then reducing greenhouse gases. Okay. Economic and comfort related benefits are of course also there. Okay. We have taken up social media, so these are some of our campaigns going around on our Twitter as well as Facebook pages. We have got the necessary clearances, because social and environmental aspects being paramount for the JICA funded projects. We have already done the environmental impact assessment reports, public consultations, right, starting from 2011 onwards. This project has been on the public domain. We have followed all those things. This is one of the smallest project affected persons will be there in terms of social impact, just 2,500, okay. Closing the project, so this is our journey right from 2011. We expect to be operational by 2020. The rolling stock will arrive by 2020, testing, commissioning, and all those things will be from 2019 to 20, okay. The current status, general consultants are on board, civil works are about to be awarded, system components for rolling stock and traction electrical systems, pre-qualifications have been invited. The remaining systems like EVS, TCS, escalators, lifts, and other things are likely to come out for the bidding. O&M, we are still considering a third-party operations or the MMRC own operations, that is still to be decided, okay. Yeah, thank you. I would like to close it here. Thank you very much.
Component of smart cities or, you know, sustainable cities. And I think it's a very important area. But one thing that you note is that for 1 kilometer of Mumbai Metro Rail, the cost is 800 crores. It's not a small amount, basically that. So the urban infrastructure, the choices have to be very judicious. And I think that's an issue that we have to really see. The total availability of funds from center and state is only 1,000 crore per city that we are planning for 100 cities. So I'll now invite Mr. Shinobu Yamamoto, who's the Mumbai representative of International Relations Division of the city of Yokohama here. Shall be grateful if you take about 10 minutes, please.
I'm Shinobu Yamamoto, Mumbai representative, city of Yokohama. I'm very honored to be here today to make a presentation on Yokohama Smart City Project. As time is limited, this will be a very short presentation. At first, let me briefly explain, introduce Yokohama. It is a beautiful port city about 20 kilometers south of Tokyo. Yokohama opened its port 156 years ago. At the time, it was merely a fishing village with a few dozen houses and approximately 100 residents. But it has grown to be the largest city in Japan as a single municipality with a population of 3.7 million. Now, I would like to talk a little about the background of Yokohama's demonstration project. This graph shows change in Yokohama's average temperature since 1901. It shows that over the past 100 years, it has risen approximately 2.7 degrees. The pictures below show flooding at Yokohama station and a city street due to typhoon. With sudden rains and hail out of season, the effect of global warming or climate change impact our lives in variety of forms. These are also linked to the increase in greenhouse gas emissions. All of Japan is experiencing an aging society and low birth rate, but Yokohama's population is forecast to increase until around 2020. The green break line is forecast CO2 emissions if we do not take any actions. 20.84 million tons are forecast for 2020. and 21.03 million for 2030. In response, Yokohama has made reducing greenhouse gas emissions a top priority, setting a short-term target of a 16% cut from 2005, the reference year, to 16.37 million tons by 2020. As a climate change policy action plan, with this background, Yokohama has formed a public-private partnership with 34 private companies to carry out this demonstration or verification, a social experiment. Let's look at the history of the project and the overall picture. The Yokohama Smart City Project, YSCP, has been promoted as a project selected by the Ministry of Economy, Trade and Industry, MITI of Japanese government, as one of its next generation energy and social system demonstration areas. The YSCP demonstration is unique in that it is a large-scale demonstration in existing urban areas. This diagram is the overall picture of our energy management efforts so far. We have developed and tested a variety of technology, including HEMS and electric vehicles for households, BEMS and FEMs for building and facilities, and linking SCADA, which groups multiple storage batteries into one large storage battery, with CEMs for community-wide energy management, to introduce various energy management technology and reduce CO2, which are the foundation of the demonstration. We set a target of 4,000 HEMs, HEMs, and have worked aggressively towards this. We have reached our target a year ahead of schedule, introducing HEMs in around 4,000 households, 37 megawatts of solar panels, and 2,300 electric vehicles. This is the entire project over time. When we began the project in 2010, a number of mechanics and systems such as HEMs and BEMs and networks especially were not developed. Because of this, we designed and developed, connected and tested over the 2 years from 2011 to 2012, and then began demonstrations such as demand response together with demand side, including citizens and businesses. These are the main results of the demonstration efforts in the household category. Within the 4,200 HEMs introduced within the city in this project, 3,500 households participated in testing, resulting in the largest demand response demonstration in Japan. Demand response is an arrangement that offers incentives proportionate to electricity usage reduction. We achieved a maximum peak cut of 15.2% through household using HEMS and implementing demand response demonstration. Integrated BEMS is a system we are introducing to manage multiple BEMS as a group. We are conducting demand response demonstration through group management of buildings with varying characteristics with the goal of cutting electricity peaks. As a result, we achieved a maximum peak cut of 22.8%. Now, let's talk about the present and future work. I'd like to introduce one example of the Yokohama already in building on the result of the demonstration. Yokohama City has 18 road administration offices, Minami Road Administration Office, one of them. The Minami Road Administration Office repair project is one example of a project to spread the successes of the demonstration. Yesterday, the Minami Road Administration Office was opened. and started its operation. It connects the energy supply of the Minami World Administration Office and the nearby Yokohama City University Medical Center, and it improves disaster preparedness. This is the first such effort at public facilities since the designated supply regulation was relaxed. A cogeneration system was introduced at the medical center and combined with overall power reception, and this is all managed by BEMS, resulting in a 5% CO2 reduction and saving of around 50 million yen in running cost per year. This project is an example of something the city of Yokohama is doing on its own, but it is necessary for Yokohama to be a circular energy city by building upon the result of YSCP demonstration. We defined a circular energy city as a city that increases the energy from its area and consumes the energy efficiently without waste. To do so, we have formed a new public-private partnership organization called the Yokohama Smart Business Council. This council promotes new efforts related to operating energy management systems and energy linkages, and spreads the technology and systems developed thus far inside and outside of Japan. Since the council was established in April 2015, 15 representative Japanese companies that agree with its mission, including Toshiba, TEPCO, Tokyo Gas, and Taisei Corporation, has joined with Yokohama to promote the project. Aiming to be a circular energy city, in order to encourage local production and consumption, we are conducting feasibility studies and formulating plans for project to be implemented next fiscal year and beyond. Furthermore, we are continuing demand response demonstration through use of BEMS at the public and private facilities and through electricity reduction at 11 power plants, demonstrating adjustment of supply and demand of electricity power by power plants. The social environment surrounding energy is expected to change, for example, with the forecast of the liberalization of electricity and gas retail. Among this, we want to continue to work through public-private partnership to construct business models based on our technology and expertise obtained from this demonstration, such as support for optimization of energy use throughout the region and the consolidation of demand-side electricity use. That's all my presentation. Thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you very much, Mr. Shinobu. I think it was a wonderful presentation on the Yokohama Smart City project. A lot to learn with respect to the energy management systems, both at the home level as well as at the community level. And the focus does remain on improving the city's contribution to the greenhouse gas emissions and its reduction in a very big way. Thank you very much indeed. I'll now like to invite Mr. Vivek Sahai. Mr. Vivek Sahai, as a matter of fact, is a former chairperson of the Railway Board of India. We have a long history of 160 years and more with respect to railways, which is our lifeline. Not only in a way connects cities, towns, villages, but actually, moves the country as such. And even now, for example, there is a project which is under implementation, what we call Delhi-Mumbai Industrial Corridor, where on this corridor there are going to be 7 new cities, and we are told they are going to be smart cities. Similarly, I think there is a dedicated freight corridor which is being constructed to move the goods, there are 2 corridors that are getting developed, one with the help of Japan very particularly,
And you know, the other one is also being taken up, Eastern Corridor, in due course of time. I'm sure that, you know, Mr. Vivek Sahai's long experience, who's currently involved as a distinguished fellow ORF Mumbai, and, you know, basically is going to really be very enlightening, and he's going to be the last speaker of the day today. Thank you so much, Mr. Vivek Sahai.
Thank you very fast. As most of the items have already been covered up, I will delve into what should be a smart city in the context of the transportation needs of that city. What is a smart city? It has already been explained by Kulwant Singh Ji. And as just to recapitulate, that ICT is to be used for handling all the aspects of a city life. You have to improve quality, performance, and interactivity, and improve the urban services. But when I try to look at how one perceives a smart city, I found that most of the services, urban services, which are being talked of, were about water, electricity, energy, and all. But transport management was missing. And now I think I'm very glad that today people have been talking about a transport management to be a key to a smart city. Because I think when do you talk of a smart thing, when you talk of a smart person, you expect certain things in him which makes him smart. So what is a smart city? A smart city is somewhere you find it comfortable to live and commute and go to a hospital, go to have 24-hour water, electricity, and all. I think that is what is a smart city. A city where you have average speed of 10 kmph for your personal car or even in your buses to reach a place, I think cannot be called a smart city. So transportation becomes a very important aspect of any smart city, especially when you are planning in a very big way on the Delhi-Mumbai industrial corridor, where new smart cities are going to come. So if we neglect the aspect of transport, I think what we will count as a smart city in our planning will be perceived by people as a very boring city. So I think we have to concentrate on this aspect, and I'm going to present my views on what this smart city should be like. So we have to improve the quality of life. I'll go now fast, it's all been discussed earlier. Now, what do you perceive as a smart city? You see, in Hollywood movies, you find cities of the future, and you'll always find that there is no GHG emission. You find a very smart kind of transportation in all these cities. This is what I took from Total Recall. The movie came in 2012. This is what probably a future city will look like. So what our smart city is going to look like after, say, 10 years when we get these cities? Transportation is shown as one bereft of any GHG emissions. Climate change has brought a new aspect to urban life. And the Paris meet of this December 15 has put very strong and very quantifiable targets on our country to achieve on GHG emissions. Can we achieve this if we don't have a proper transport mechanism in an urban life? I think this will be a very tall task to achieve if we don't have a proper transport policy for an urban center. In my view, any smart city will have to have public transport as the mainstay of all transportation need of people of all class. Even the richest people should not be daunted by traveling in a public transport. Once we achieve that, I think that is what would be a smart city of the future. If a person is feeling that he should move in his own personal car and clog up the roads, I think that is not going to be a smart city. So I am going to answer how can we make public transport acceptable to every walk of life in an urban setup. These are the characteristics which I think are very germane to this issue. They should be an average speed of 50 kmph or above. If we don't provide a 50 kmph, that means a distance of 30 kilometers should be covered up in about 35 to 40 minutes. If we achieve that, people would love to travel by that. I can share this with you that a lot of people travel by Mumbai suburban services only because of the speed that they provide. Because the roads are so clogged that if they have to reach somewhere fast, they say, train le lo, chahe khade huye jayenge. Even if you are standing, it is better to go by train because you will save about 15 to 20 minutes of your precious time. It should be economical. We can't have a system where I think that if you construct something at 800 crores per kilometer, I think you are going to invest so much in the capital cost is going to be so high that how will you recover it? So that is one aspect which should agitate our mind. We should avoid fossil fuels to eliminate GHG emissions. I think the solution for this has to be seen if we see how a mechanism created by nature works. And that is the human body. How does blood flow in our body? And I'll make a comparison with that because that is how people should flow in a smart city. Flow of blood is essential for life in a human body in the same way as flow of people provides vigor and energy to a town. And nature has created this mechanism. You see, you have two very important channels. These are where the maximum flow of blood takes place, aorta and superior vena cava. And then you have got arteries and veins, and where you have got the last mile connectivity, you have got capillaries. And now we see, when you are designing for a smart city, you must first calculate what is going to be your passenger's PHPD. That is, per hour, peak direction, how many passengers you want to carry. If it is 40,000 and above, say up to 70,000, that is akin to your aorta or superior vena cava, and that can be provided only by the suburban rail transport, like of which is available in Mumbai. That is the Central Railway and Western Railway are the aorta and superior vena cava of your town, where you are carrying about 100,000 passengers per hour in peak direction every day. The next is 10 to 40,000. These are like your ordinary veins and arteries, and this can be provided by metro, sky bus, and BRT. But the capillaries are your cycling, walking, buses on the small street, because there you will achieve below 10,000 PHPD. You can't achieve more than that. Now, if you plan for something, say, for 10,000 to 40,000 PHPD, you'll say that we'll do it with rickshaws and buses, you'll fail. You'll clog up the channels of movement. If you'll plan for 40,000 to 50,000 by metros and BRT, you'll fail. So when you are having the architecture of the transport in a smart city, this is what you have to keep in mind. I think that we should now provide in a smart city elevated bus rapid transport. And this elevated bus rapid transport will become very cheap because if you have elevated bus route, it's purely bus route. No private car can come on it, no auto rickshaws, no autos. It should be a public transport where you will provide a service on a very fixed timings, and it should be air-conditioned buses so that every walk of life finds it convenient to use it. Then please remember that when you go in for, why the cost of metro is so high? Because you plan for about 20 to 25 ton axle load in your elevated or underground services. But if you are having only for buses, you can provide the superstructure for about 5 to 6 ton axle load. And that will bring down the cost tremendously. You can also use, this is a sky bus, I'll come to that little later. The architecture, this is what I feel, that we should have the arterial route, that these two arterial routes, this should not be mixed with the other movement of passengers, which will be towards the residential area. And you should provide flow in such a manner that people find it convenient to travel comfortably from one mode to another and reach their destinations. That one was for the Mumbai, and this is for Delhi, where the concentric circle is there. But then how do you achieve the elevated bus rapid transport is the picture has not come very clean, but when you are having the elevated bus rapid transport, you can have two lanes where you can have an express lane and you have a stopping bus every kilometer. These two lanes will cater for the long distances and short distances. And if you do that, I feel that we'll be able to provide a service for about 40 to 50,000 passengers in the peak direction per hour. And it will be comfortable for everybody. You can have a bus coming every 30 seconds at this stop. stopping on the express lane at every 5 kilometers and stopping at every 1 kilometer on the slow lane, and it should be possible for you to cover your distances at about 50 kmph speed. And if we do that for a smart city, I think that is the future of transport. And then you should provide with sky buses, by ordinary buses, the next leg going to your residences. You can even have good pedestrian tracks so that people could walk 1 kilometer and reach those distances. And you can have auto rickshaws, you can have electric rickshaws. And in these buses, a lot of research is going on for electric buses now. And Elon Musk is working, the Tesla company is working on buses in the electric cars. They have succeeded in the electric buses. I found out that they have already successfully tested a bus which in one charge goes about 480 kilometers. Once this is established, I think very easily we can have electric buses as the mainstay of your urban transport. And till that technology comes here, you can have buses running on CNG, so that your GHG emission is totally taken care of, and the elevated bus route provides you uninterrupted services, and then we should be able to give the smart look to an urban center. We can have cycles, which Mr. Jagtap, Rajin Jagtap showed. We can have the last mile connectivity by cycles. You can have walking on good pedestrian pathways, and then that is the architecture that we should be having in mind, and then we will have efficient and user-friendly transportation, which is a sine qua non for a smart city. We'll have to take a fresh look. It will be a disruptive technology. It is not thought of anywhere. I think it will not only be made in India, it will be made in India for a solution, transport solution for an urban center, a smart city of India, which I think will be followed by everybody. And I hope that a day is not far when an efficient transportation within a city will be a matter of right for its citizen. It should be, we have right to education, we have various kinds of rights. I think there should be a right to proper mobility in an urban town. Only then it should be called as urban city. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I think some of the highlights where he mentioned about electric mobility in particular, there are sort of a lot of initiatives which are already there to move away from the, you know, conventional modes to electric mobility. There's a Government of India scheme with the Department of Heavy Industry with a target of achieving almost like 30% vehicles on electric mobility, including cars. There are obviously, you know, manufacturers like Mahindra Reva who have started manufacturing electric cars, and there is a talk with respect to cost reduce of electric buses, which are at this moment very high. So there's a kind of effort that's going on. And there are initiatives which I like to particularly mention. Hyderabad Metro Rail, actually, which will be starting very shortly, the, you know, first stretch of about 12 kilometers and then beyond. They have got 63 stations and they are connecting for the last mile connectivity, battery operated cycles. And the local Hyderabad Bicycle Association has taken the lead in this regard. So there are initiatives which are now in place, and I am sure that transport, which remains a very important area for a smart city, as you very rightly explained, how the blood flows in the body and how the people move in the city. Therefore, as a matter of fact, sustainable urban transport is a key agenda for all the smart cities, irrespective of whether we call them as smart cities. We are not talking of 100 cities. You know, we have to make all the 8,000 cities in this country, you know, where the transport is as sustainable as possible. There's a lot to learn also from Japan. There are a lot of initiatives that are there. With that, I think, you know, we conclude the presentations, but I'll open the floor for a few questions.